On today's show,
Kobe Bryant's final game or the Warriors' shot at 73. Which ticket would you rather have?
In the up-down report, is Randy Whitman on the hot seat? Should Draymond be listed at center for All-NBA?
And in Crossfire, we hand out some anti-awards to this season's best underachievers.
It's Tuesday, April 12th. The Stutter starts now.
Welcome to the Starters. Whether you're listening to the podcast or joining us on NBA TV or YouTube, doesn't matter. We're happy to have you. I'm J.E. Skeets, and alongside me, as always, that's Tass Mellis.
We just talked about cricket for 10 minutes. That's 10 more minutes than I've ever heard about cricket in my life.
And the man leading that conversation, to Tass's right, the international man of mystery, taking it to the max, Lee Ellis.
Friend,
Lele.
There will be no cricket talk.
Come on, just a little bit.
Say
like,
when you get no, that. No. Last, certainly not least, over there, Starters blog editor, Trey Kirby.
Heyo!
Heyo!
TK, what do you got for us tonight?
Whole bunch of cricket highlights. Just kidding, I'm here at the internet looking for your best tweets at #TheStarters, and yesterday, we showed you Jeremy Lin's newest hair maneuver, rocking the double ponytail and looking like Rey from The Force Awakens. But as it turns out, as we found out on Game Time, it wasn't totally his idea.
You know, sometimes I go to a city and a friend wants this, or, you know, someone challenges me to do this, or, you know, saw something, my hair's long enough, now I can do that.
Well, good for you, and good to know that you take suggestions as well. Maybe we can come up with something
for
you.
Oh, yeah. Let me know.
That's right, Jeremy Lin takes hair requests from fans, which brings us to today's question. What hairstyle should Jeremy Lin wear next? He could try the weird thing that's very popular now where you pull the top of your hair into a bun, let everything else dangle. I think it's called the half top knot. I don't know, it's popping. He could try it. Or he could help us on our quest to bring back cornrows.
Yeah.
We're one player away from an all cornrows team. Maybe it's Jeremy Lin, or he could dye it blonde and rock the Bieber locks. It's a bold look, but if he gets this, you know what he could do when he's on the court. Straight up hit him with the Bieber cross.
Oh, yeah!
I mean, he's got the handles. If he's got the hair, why wouldn't he be able to pull this off?
Well, maybe the power is in the hat Bieber's wearing.
Yeah, I guess there's only one way to know, Skeets.
Yeah, that's true.
But we want to hear from you. Send us what you think Jeremy Lin's next hairstyle should be at #TheStarters, and we'll hear from you a little bit later.
Mm. All right, get those tweets in. We got a fun show tonight. We got Crossfire, where Tass and I go head-to-head, and we have the up-down report. But we start with a little what you got. If you're new to the show, it's pretty simple. Trey presents us with two related topics. We have to determine the better choice. The catch, though, there's only one right answer, and that's whatever TK thinks. Play along on Twitter, #TheStarters. Trey, first one.
Our first topic, believe it or not, Kobe Bryant only has one game left in his entire NBA career. Comes Wednesday night against the Jazz. It is truly a must-see event, except the Warriors are going for an all-time best 73rd win at the exact same time. Which tickets would you rather have? Kobe's last game or the Warriors' shot at history? What you got?
Wow.
It's
tough. That's a good one.
It's very tough. But I think you got to go with the Warriors. It feels like we've been watching Kobe's last game this entire season, and I don't want to remember Kobe this way.
Mm-hmm.
I do not. I think the best part about Kobe's last game is probably going to be his post-game press conference. We're living in the present. And I think you should change the way you worded that, Trey. It's not the Warriors going for 73. It's the Warriors getting 73.
Whoa, whoa.
And I think
Matt
there's
Barnes,
a difference.
Matt Barnes says maybe not.
Yeah, maybe not. They had their chance on Saturday night. It's not happening. The Warriors getting 73 is a present-day record. Kobe's best days are in the past. That's the way it is. I'm living in the present.
Lee, do you agree with them?
Yes, I do, because...
You guys are both wrong. Why?
Look, this is not a farewell to Kobe as far as he's going to go out there and score 48 points and turn on a great performance. He's probably only going to score 15 points. There's going to be a lot of emotion there in the crowd. It's not going to be a great game.
Probably.
Yeah.
Going to be a lot of emotion. Come on.
But
the ovation, the standing ovation at the beginning when he's announced, I'm sure at some point during the game is going to happen.
Yeah.
At the end of the game. That's why, to me, Kobe is the sort of more bigger, more memorable ticket if you could only pick between one or
well,
the two of them.
Well, I feel lucky that I was able to see Kobe a lot in his prime in person, and he was great. And this game is not one, like you say, I don't want to remember him for this last game where he probably won't have a great game. And the Warriors are going for something that I know we thought the Bulls record would never be beaten. It's probably going to be beaten tomorrow night. Not only that, Steph Curry could hit 400 three-pointers in a season. I want to see that.
Okay, that's amazing. Let me ask you guys a question. Who did the Bulls beat to win 72? It was their 72nd.
The Washington Bullets.
You're correct.
Calvert Chaney had a great game.
I mean, I don't know how you actually pulled that out of your mind.
I'm riding
impressive.
With the Bulls. I'm riding
but
with the
Bulls. But my point is, it's not really, you're not going to really remember that last game to the historic season of the Warriors.
Do you remember Michael's?
You're not going to remember Kobe's last game.
Yeah,
you don't
remember
Jordan's last game.
I absolutely do remember Jordan's.
How many did he score?
It was on the road, I believe. Someone can fact check me, Trey. I think it was against Philadelphia.
Right.
He didn't have a great game.
Right.
But there was moments when he got pulled out of that game. They were getting killed by the 76ers, if I remember correctly. And the crowd started up. Yeah. On the road, the crowd started up. The Jordan chants.
Yeah.
And, of course, Collins puts him back in. Like, that's a moment.
Yeah.
You're going to remember
that. Well, this is the other thing about Kobe. We know he's idolized Jordan so much. He's probably going to come back in a year or two and play some more games anyway. So there might be some more to his career.
Another reason you got to pick the Warriors, it's so much cheaper to go see the Golden State Warriors game
that's
rather
fair.
Than
that's
the Kobe
fair.
Game. It's about half the price. Yeah. The listed price is about $700 per ticket average, according to TipIQ.
And
LA, it's $1,400. The $700 you save, you can go see some Warriors playoff games.
Hey, but also, the celebs who are going to be at Kobe are there for themselves anyway. They want to be seen at the game.
Oh, get out of here.
They do. Everyone's going to have sunglasses on.
It's right, about the interviews.
What's the correct answer here? There's only one right answer. Trey.
The answer is Kobe.
Yes!
And I think it's a pretty hard choice, but it is Kobe. It's a once-in-a-lifetime thing to see him play his last game. And Skeets, I checked. Turns out Michael Jordan's last game was Game 6, 1998, against the Utah Jazz. Who knew?
No.
You're right, though. It was the Philadelphia. Nonetheless, we asked the fans which game they'd rather be at. They all want to go see the Warriors. Apparently, they're all youngsters. You can see a record fall any year. You can't see Kobe retire any single year. That's true.
Oh, yeah, you can see somebody win the most games in NBA history every year.
I've seen it twice, and I'm the youngest one here.
All right. It's a tough one. Let's hear from you guys on Twitter, though. What do you think? Next topic.
Last night, the Utah Jazz lost to the Dallas Mavericks, lost their hold on the eighth seed in the West, and lost control of their destiny heading into Wednesday night. Meanwhile, the Celtics got smoked at home by a team they might see in the first round and might have lost home court advantage. What was the worst loss, the Jazz or the Celtics? What you got?
It has to be the Jazz because they've dropped out of the playoff race now. The Celtics are still in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Who cares about seeding? The Jazz have been playing playoff basketball for the last few weeks, and last night was a real test, and they went up against a battle-proven team in the Dallas Mavericks and lost at home. I know they lost Rudy Gobert, which certainly hurt when he went down, but for the Jazz, this is actually a learning experience for them, I think, and it could help them in the future if they do miss out on the playoffs this year. So, tough for this year, but for going forward as a learning development thing, I think it's okay.
But it sure felt like they learned something last week when they lost to the Clippers
in
their barn without everybody on their roster.
You can't just keep saying that.
Yeah, exactly.
I know,
and this felt like a playoff series loss last night because it's basically the end of their season, and it really hurts. You showed Deron Williams in that clip there. Mm. It was cool to see Deron Williams go off. He should really imagine Utah fans booing him every single night.
He plays amazing.
He played great. He led them in scoring. He looks like Deron Williams right there, jumping all over the place, finding his openings.
Yeah.
That's the Deron we fell in love with. You got a Wesley Matthews on this team that's been on fire the last month. This team, I'm starting to get a little bit excited about going to the postseason. You know they're going to play very well. Right now, in the 7-hole, could match up with the Spurs. And you know that they play them fairly well. We'll see where they fall. But I'm getting a little bit excited for the Dallas Mavs, Utah Jazz. Man, that really hurts.
That was a tough loss. We should point out, they're not officially out of it.
No.
They need to beat Kobe and the Lakers on the final night of the season. If you've got tickets, congrats. And, of course, they need the Rockets to lose to the tanking Kings.
Yeah.
So they
who aren't playing anybody.
Utah's
destiny is out of their hands.
Yeah, that's what sucks. I will say, to play devil's advocate, because I agree with you guys a little bit, it's probably the Jazz is the worst loss. That Celtics one, that was ugly.
Mm.
The Hornets went on a 31-3 run in that first half. And the game was over then. They could never get closer than something like 14 or 15. It's a bad loss because they very well could lose home court advantage.
Yeah.
Because they're, of course, in this logjam of a mess in the Eastern Conference, 3-6. The Hawks are happy despite losing last night because they're guaranteed home court advantage at the very least. Celtics may have lost it. And the only reason I bring that up is because this is a team that made the playoffs last year, which a team like the Jazz are trying to do, like get in there. The Celtics did that last year, got swept by the Cavs. They want to take the next step, which is to win a first-round series. Home court advantage would obviously help them out in that. So that was a tough loss, especially when you add it with the loss to the Hawks not too long ago.
Mm.
Brutal losses, again, in that logjam. What's the correct answer to this one, Trey?
Well, it's the Jazz. Yeah. They are out of the playoffs, and they lost Gobert. Kind of a double bad scenario for them. But our final topic, it took just 18 first-half minutes for Russell Westbrook to notch his 18th triple-double of the season last night, the most by any player since Magic in 81-82. His teammate Kevin Durant went for 34 points 64th straight game he scored 20 or more, which is the most since Kobe in 05-06. What's the more impressive achievement, Russ's triple-doubles or Durant's scoring streak? What you got?
Might be that dribble over Robert Sacre's head. I mean, that was pretty mean.
It's Westbrook.
It's Westbrook, yeah.
Durant, you don't think Durant's what he's done good? He averages 27 for his career.
That's what
he's
I
led
can't
the league
stand.
In scoring four times.
I know, but I mean, so it's an average of 20. It's impressive. It's consistency, but it's nowhere close to his total.
No.
Points per game average.
Yeah,
so how can you pick it?
It's totally arbitrary.
It's fabricated.
It's a cool sounding number. 20 sounds great. Okay, he scores over it all the time. Russell Westbrook, I mean, anytime Magic Johnson's name is coming up, which he's tied him there for the most triple doubles in, like, whatever, the last 30, 40 years, it's unbelievable. Trey, correct answer, gotta be Russell Westbrook.
Yeah, that's Westbrook.
Okay.
No doubt.
All right, good. Glad we're all on the same page. All right, lots more still to come on the show tonight when we return. Tess and I go head to head in a special anti awards edition of Crossfire.
Welcome to Crossfire. This is how it works. Trey will give Skeets and me three topics. We'll debate each one. And you at home will declare the winner because you're going to tweet a lot. Trey, it somehow works.
Yeah, if you're following along on Twitter and you think Tass is winning, tweet hashtag Tass wins. If you think Skeets is winning, it's hashtag Skeets wins. All the tweets count, so tweet early, tweet often. And hey, guys, this Friday is our third annual award show, The Starties. Woo! Hosted by Kristen Ledlow, we'll be giving out some major hardware like MVP and ROI. And also some majorly silly hardware like Wedgie of the Year and Funniest Moment, so tune in for that. But today is the Anti-Awards, and for round one, the first thing I need to know is, who is the NBA's worst sportsman of the year? Here we go!
Worst sportsman of the year has to be Doug McDermott of the Chicago Bulls.
Huh?
He's a monster. Did you see him tackle Hassan Whiteside like a football player, like Ed Reed? Or John Lynch or Bobby Wagner.
Oh, great name, dating yourself.
Or Luke Kuechly. No, it's gonna be Doug. He's never had a flagrant.
You're saying football
he's
name.
Never
that's
had
all
a
you're
flagrant
saying.
Or a technical in his career, and then he just goes and football tackles his line sight. He's a monster. He's a monster. He's a
it's Rajon Rondo. He has actually hurt his earning potential, and that's saying something because his numbers are fantastic. He has been the worst sportsman of the year. This is not what a brilliant man does. He doesn't pull a man's shorts from the bench. That is unsportsmanlike. This, because he's labeled as brilliant, is labeled as a brilliant move when he fakes a free throw, that doesn't do anything but get your opponents ready. And this was obviously the worst, the derogatory homophobic slur thrown at Bill Kennedy, the worst sportsman, the worst taste. I just did not like watching Rajon Rondo at all this year, despite his great numbers.
He's still gonna get paid, though. That's the crazy part.
I think it hurt. I think it hurt his earning potential, though.
I like that pick. You win.
All right.
Give me my phone.
You
I
did say you
task.
Luke Kuechly, though, so props to you for that. Round two. Not everyone can sign Shaquille O'Neal and draft and trade for Kobe Bryant the same summer. Shout out to Jerry West. So tell me, what's been the worst move of the season? Here we go.
It's gotta be Ty Lawson going to the Rockets. The Nuggets basically gave him away. The Rockets plugged him in as their starter right away, and they got off to the worst start in NBA history, losing three games by 20 or more right away. The worst thing is, he took Patrick Beverley's spot, and you look at this team. Patrick Beverley, Trevor Ariza, Dwight Howard in your starting lineup, that should be a very good defensive team. I want to know what that team would look like if Patrick Beverley was there being his snotty self in the starting lineup. It'd be a very different season.
You loved this move at the time.
I didn't.
As did I. Yes,
I
you
said
did.
He
we
should be on
did.
The bench.
We
I said he
did.
Should be on the bench right away.
The worst move that we all jumped on right away because it was dumb was the Kings salary dump back in 2015 offseason when they traded Nick Stauskas, Carl Landry, Jason Thompson, and a future top 10 protected pick and the right to swap two first rounders. For what? For nothing. The hopes to get Rondo, who, yeah, they got. Monte Ellis they were trying for. Wesley Matthews they were trying for. That was a brutal trade at the time, still is, and they're going to pay for it.
At least
that's
they didn't waive
move.
Any of those guys. The Rockets waived Ty Lawson.
Fair point. Final round. NBA highlights are awesome, but NBA lowlights are awesomely funny. What's been the worst play of the season? Here we go!
I had to go with the Rockets play. There were many to pick from. But ultimately, I'm going to go with the James Harden, Dwight Howard, botched alley-oop. This was just perfect. A perfect microcosm of the Rockets' terribly disappointing season. You know, Dwight doesn't jump because he assumes Harden's going to shoot. Ball smashes off the backboard. Everybody throws their hands up like, what's going on here? What are we doing? That was perfect. Worst play of the season, hands down.
We've seen botched oops before. What we haven't seen is a flat-footed block. This never happens in the league. And it's a Rockets play as well. Ty Lawson gets blocked by Raymond Felton, who's standing there. When do you see that other than in grade school basketball? This doesn't happen in the NBA. This was a rare little nugget found on a Saturday night by me. Pat myself on the back.
You? You're the only person to find this?
Yes, I was the only human
in the world. You're the only person watching the Rockets play, probably, yeah.
I was the only human in the world who saw this play.
Wow. Wow. That's unbelievable. I hope you were not a Rockets fan or a Kings fan while you were watching this crowd.
Tass wins! That play himself, y'all.
Wow.
All Tass.
Way to watch basketball.
And the pits are dry. And the pits are dry.
We got to take a break. Lots more still to come. Should the Wizards move on from Randy Whitman? That and more in the Up-Down Report. Come on back. Welcome back to the Starters, right into the Up-Down Report, where we figure where the four of us stand on some NBA topics. Ask you to do the same. Jump on Twitter, hashtag the Starters, thumbs up or thumbs down. First one, guys, according to Brian Windhorst of ESPN, the Washington Wizards are expected to fire Randy Whitman this offseason. Brian cites the Wizards' complete collapse defensively and their inability to execute as a few of the big reasons why Whitman might be on the way out. So, guys, thumbs up or down on the Wizards considering firing Randy Whitman. What do you think?
I'm actually down.
Interesting. When he signed his extension back in 2014, I think a lot of us thought he probably won't make it to the end of it, but he had earned it at the time. It was the Wizards' first playoff series victory in 9 seasons. How do you not give it to him? But I think the stagnation has definitely set in, and that's definitely going to be a problem because through Whitman's tenure, the younger players who are not stars, besides Brad Beal and John Wall, basically, have really struggled to develop. And when you're a team trying to make it to the next level, you got to have young guys getting better. And that hasn't been the case in Washington.
That's true. If they are going to fire him, they need to have someone that they know is going to get the best out of these players. And it's going to be a little bit hard. There's always a few coaching changes in the offseason. And it's an interesting situation right now with Washington because Bradley Beal, we know, is a free agent, restricted. But he didn't have a great season because of injury. John Wall was an all-star. He was good. But what do you do with all those other players? You know, the Gortats, the Nenes, the Otto Porters. How do you get the best out of those guys? Because is that coaching or is that just effort?
See, that's why I have a problem with this. I understand Randy Whitman could get fired, and I totally understand it. But I think that takes the blame off of some of the players.
True.
And yes, they probably will get better with another coach who can motivate, but they weren't self-motivated. And that's my problem. Just looking around, the talk about that locker room, yes, Randy Whitman's to blame, but so are all the other leaders in there and everyone inside it.
Yeah, but that's exactly right. You can't fire everyone else on your team. So the coach gets fired.
Yeah, you need to shake it up. Fired, sure.
So that's why I think this is going to happen. I think he saved himself with that playoff spot. Yeah. They've gotten worse defensively, as Windhorst pointed out. Not great. And we got to remember, this was a team that people thought, they might challenge for the number one or two seed in the East after going into the playoffs a little deeper than they had expected. And now they're not even in the playoffs. Yeah. I mean, that's a heck of a drop-off.
Yeah, they've had a rough season, for sure.
It's like McHale basically 80 games later, though, to me. The guys didn't come to play, and the coach is going to pay for it.
Yeah, all right. Sure. Moving on here, guys. According to Professor Zach Lowe, voters can list Golden State Warriors do-it-all big man Draymond Green at center for all NBA and other awards if they want, and that probably makes Draymond happy, seeing as he said last week that he should be considered at the center position. So, guys, up or down on the league allowing Draymond Green to be listed as a center for awards? Thumbs up, thumbs down. Thumbs up from me.
Why?
Super. Yeah. Why not?
Because he doesn't play at center. Yeah, I don't want to be a stickler. He plays at 15% of his minutes, he plays at center. Okay. The other 85%, he plays with a bogey or he plays with an Azili, and that's the way it is.
When does he play center, or what lineup does he play center on?
He plays
the best lineup by far in the league.
Exactly. There's a reason for that.
And you're going to see it time and time again in the playoffs. Yeah. Why not? I mean,
but there's a reason for that, because he can't do it entire game. That's why it's the best lineup, because if Draymond started at center, if the opening intro said, and at center, Draymond Green, he wouldn't be part of the best lineup.
Well, okay, so why did we get rid of it in the All-Star game?
Yeah, why did we?
That's what I think is the reason he shouldn't be a center is because, like Tess is saying, he's not a center, and center should still have something in the league to play for. If you get rid of all of the center spots in All-Star and All-NBA, what are those guys going to get for awards?
But the line has been blurred between positions.
Yeah, and that's probably a good thing.
I think if someone like Anthony Davis, let's say, as a center, it has a great season, he's going to get in the first team anyway. I think they should do away with positions entirely and have... This is a very important award. This counts when it comes to Hall of Fame and stuff. There's only 15 of them. There should be the 15 best players throughout the league. They never play a game. There's no exhibition or anything.
Yeah.
It's an accolade that you look back at the end of your career and say, I was an All-NBA, first, second, or third, whatever.
Yeah, but there are three positions out on the court. Guards, wings, centers. You got to give the center something at some point.
Agree, disagree? Let us know on Twitter. We're obviously torn on both of these. We got to take one more break. When we come back, hopefully we're not as torn on Lee's selection for very solid play.
That's I don't know beauty. If you should have chose this one, actually.
Yeah, I sometimes get angry with you to fix them. Back with the starters, Trey, the only one of us to correctly pick those crazy Rockets to pick up the win last night in the pick and play over the Wolves. Congrats to you. So look, it's down to this. It's either Lee or myself getting a pie in the face on tomorrow's show. Wow, the final night here, Lee. One of us is doing a Mrs. Doubtfire.
You're getting Doubtfire.
It's actually pretty fun.
So let's...
I agree.
I'd rather you do it.
Yeah, pie's great. So let's see the picks for tonight. Wow, here we go. Perfect. Three of us are taking the Heat, including myself. And Lee, you're the only one taking the Pistons at home.
I believe in Stan.
Pistons win. I get the pie. Heat win. Lee gets the pie. Lee, VSP.
We're going to Oklahoma City for a gentle boomerang here from Randy Foy. Just watch Randy here. Ball moves around, gets back here to Nikki Buckets Collison, and he lays it in beautifully to Randy Foy. Watch this. This is just such a smart pass. Nick Collison only had one assist last night, and what a corker. That's beautiful. That's what I call a very solid play.
What a corker. Whatever that is.
Looks is that cricket talk?
Not quite.
The bat could be made of cork. That would make sense.
No, they're not supposed to be. Oh. Willow. Oh, right. English willow.
Oh, it's like baseball. Sometimes there's a fantastic play doesn't make the highlight packs. That's why we have the highlight that wasn't like this Jason Smith block. No, it's a foul. What? It was a fantastic block by Jason Smith.
Come on.
How dare you call that a foul? Either way, it worked out for us because it's the highlight that wasn't.
And you know he's dancing afterwards.
Yeah, right. Lee, you got a few fan signs.
Logan and his bud were in Oakland last week and they sent in this sign. Thank you very much, guys. Maggie took her son to his first ever NBA game and smartly took a sign so he'll never forget the moment. Very solid shirt. Great job out there.
Killing it.
This is Anya and her twin daughters, Lauren and Sophia. Dad Mark is behind the camera. They flew over from England.
Wow.
Just to watch the Dubs go for 73. And the last one comes in from Michael and his lovely wife, Dara. They actually sent in a sign one other time and it said Michael and his friend. So I'm saying this time it's Michael and his wife, Dara. They're at the Thunder game. Thank you very much.
Love is love. Love is love. Guys, an hour-long show tomorrow night, 6 p.m. Eastern, getting you ready for the final night of the NBA regular season.
It's here, baby. Thanks for joining us, folks. And remember, someone's always watching.
Brace the night, people.